In the next two lessons, we're going to be defining the columns of data we want included in our event frame. And we do that through the event frame template. The first type of data we want to add to the event frame are asset attribute aggregations. And these are aggregations that come from attributes of the element template. So for instance, in this case, we have you can see the yellow trace there of the dryer outlet temperature. We're going to add a column for the average outlet temperature and the maximum temperature, for instance. We'll also add some aggregations of other attributes. In this case, the red trace shows the temperature of the regenerate flow. So if you remember, when we regenerate the molecular sieve, we drive the water out of it using a hot vapor. This is the temperature of that vapor stream. And for completeness, we decide that maybe we'd like to have that included in our event frame. So we're going to pick up the average temperature of that flow as well as its maximum. The way you add these aggregations to your event frame template is through the syntax shown in the settings column below. So we'll be going into PiSystem Explorer to take a look at how we've set up the event frames in this example. Back in PiSystem Explorer, we're in the library view where we're going to be looking at the event frame template. If you go up to the upper left-hand corner under the event frame templates branch, you'll see that there's an event frame template selected called My Dryer Regeneration Cycle. And this is the one we'll be using in these exercises. Now you can see that we've specified a naming pattern using the Asset Analytics Substitution language. So we have the element name, my regeneration cycle, etc. This is something that's important to give the event frames a name that's searchable so you can find the one you're interested in. So you might want to think about how you'd like your event frames named when you create them. If you want, off to the right, and you click on the little arrow, there's a list of the different types of things you might consider for including in your event frame name. Now, if you go to the Attributes Templates tab, this is where we've defined the attributes for our event frame. So each of these attributes will become a column of the event frame record. Skipping down to the second section, if you select any of these attributes, you'll see off to the right under the Settings Configuration dialog where we've specified the syntax required to drag the appropriate attribute from the calling element. And we've also specified the type of aggregation we'd like. So in this case, we're referencing the outlet temperature for the dryer, and we're looking for the average. If we'd like a maximum, then we'll specify the aggregation method maximum. So when this event frame is called from either dryer A or dryer B, we'll get the appropriate calculation for the right time range and the right tag coming through the attribute of the element. Now up at the top, you can see the grouping of asset analytic calculations. These are really just placeholders at this point. You'll notice in the configuration dialog, we haven't specified that they're a pie point. We've given them no configuration stream. We've selected a units of measure. But the results for these calculations will actually come from our event frame analytic that we're going to configure in the next lesson. And it's kind of nice because they are not bound to the start and end time of the event frame. They'll be calculated in asset analytics, and then they'll be posted into the event frame upon the close of the event frame. So this gives you flexibility to add quite a bit of other information to your event frame record, as you'll see in the next lesson. So this is it for this one. Now we'll move on to looking at what we have to do in Asset Analytics to calculate these attributes.